basically this story that we dealt with last week, of the man who was incident and paralyzed, he was unable to walk, and he was waiting at the chief gate pool of Bethesda. Verse 3 says, indeed, lay a great number of people blind, lame, and paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. An angel went down to the surface, troubled the water. Observe that first after the trouble, the water stepped in and made it home for whatever disease it had. A certain man was there about 39 years. Jesus saw him lying there, and knew that he'd been there just now a long time. He said, and they will not be there. He answered, sir, I have no man. But the water is troubled. Put me into the pool of the water. Another step down before me. Present steel. reflections. And so, now, once again, we kind of address this a little bit. If a person is depending on the Lord is answering this, he's fixing that, moving here, he's healing me here, he's touching me, bring God, we need a touch, in some sort of manifestation, letting you know that God still loves you, that you're still with God, God's with you, you know. Then should that, should for whatever reason the day ever come that God doesn't, that's one thing, but what if he doesn't move and something else presents itself as an answer to that problem? And you have trained yourself that Jesus is pretty much your helper, your co-pilot, your deliverer. And it's almost as if his lordship is Lord over those things. Well, you know, there is a difference between suffering and the suffering of Christ. I'm not going to divide it this way, but to help you see the difference, you can almost say suffering for Christ or the suffering of Christ. But I'm going to say suffering as opposed to suffering of Christ. And we are partakers, but we fellowship in suffering of Christ. What is the difference? Suffering, and we could be suffering as a Christian, but suffering is the present pressure, whether in the soul or the body, of a painful situation or literal pain in your life. And a person can be deceived and say, oh, suffering is virtuous in itself, just suffering. You know, and I've often said, well, if suffering is virtuous, or if suffering itself makes you a son of God, makes you spiritual, that would be put into your most spiritual in the world. But they're not. So suffering in and of itself has no virtue. But a person can, and this is where you get the concept of a martyr spirit. It's not the spirit of the Lamb. Right now. of suffering that only he can suffer, and that only a person who has his nature can suffer. The just for the unjust. You don't get a lot of that of suffering, self-centeredness, self-righteousness, pride, or even self-pity. Because all of those things are unjust. So to truly, we're talking about this situation in John chapter 5. We're talking about, is deliverance the answer or Christ the answer? And if deliverance is the answer, you can find deliverance. You can maybe even pay somebody enough money to put you in that pool. So that, could it be possible that somebody suffered for Christ, for the sufferings of Christ, actually, and through that not miss Jesus, but not find the difference? And I say, that is the way. I'm sorry. I say that is the way. I say that Jesus is good. Goodness to touch us or to heal or to put the bondage here to do this, just lack goodness, but it is goodness as a result of his character. His character is all things, and you have to meet every situation by Christ. And you know, you have to say every situation. Now, you know, maybe we don't, maybe we need some, maybe we need something more. The goal should be all situations by Christ, because Christ is the goal. I mean, if Christ is the goal, I can assure you, you are not open to any deception if deliverance becomes the goal. Or the contrast of deliverance, just suffering. See, because they're both, they're extreme. Then you miss Christ. You miss Christ. This man, had he gotten into that pool, could have been made whole, meaning he could have taken up his way to home. But what would his life have been? What would it have been like? And the fact that he couldn't do it, the fact that he couldn't remedy his situation, and that brings in another thought. And always, the God sometimes brings us to a place where we can't remedy our situation so that there's have been in our situation long enough to go to fall in a heap and go, I need you. Not just I need an answer. Because sometimes by allowing us what I call stewing, and just for many of you who are already leaders, both are moving leaders, I can say that stewing plays a very big part. But it's not, and don't misunderstand, I believe that God puts us in a pot more than that. Because he's trying to bring forth the gold. He doesn't have some sort of hand. Let us sometimes do things. I don't believe that's what's going on in his heart. That goes back to what I shared Sunday about his purpose. You see an action, you go, well, that guy's just me. You know, well, God's just me. I tell you, he is full of mercy. But in his mercy, it says he hath afflicted us. Did you know? Can I explain that? I'll tell you. In his mercy, he's trying to bring us out of bondage. And the bondage, we think, is the problems that we face. And that's not the bondage. The bondage is what's inside. And that's why we react to those things so much. That is why. Because we are dead in bondage to that. So, sometimes we stew in that. The purpose is not to let us stew in a situation until we hate the situation or whatever. That will happen, but that's not really the purpose. The purpose is to let us stew in it. And a lot of times, by not remedying it quickly or even coming and talking to us about it, what comes out of it begins to be attitudes, words sometimes, and actions that we take that are that. There's a need. Now, we don't see it that way. There's a problem. The main reason why it's a problem, not a need, is just seek suffering isn't the answer. This person had an opportunity for deliverance over there, but there was a problem. All these other people beat him to the punch. He couldn't get the help that he needed because these people walked out first and there wasn't anybody to help. Nobody's helping him. I get a little help here, I'm with him. And you know, Jesus says he won't be. Spiritual truth found in the original sin, Jesus. safety. It is, how are we seeing? What do we see? And what do we see by receiving by? I see this thing, I've been getting this for years, and I haven't been painted, and it's got a dent here, and it looks really bad. That's just really bad, okay? That's fine. You know, we'll get around to it one day or another. Or I can just start living here and just go, okay, well, let's fix everything up. But I have a mandate from the Lord to spend my eyes here, knowing the Lord first, and I will fix things later. And my wife's the same way. She has a mandate, she serves the Lord constantly. And if the house ends up really messed up, you know, she don't get flack from her husband because she gives her life to Jesus. And I'm never going to do it in a bad way like all of this. It's the spirit of the Lord is first. And if I can get to this, we don't get to do that approach. It's not the case. I'm saying, there are first things first. There are first things first with the Lord. Now, with us, that's different. But you, regardless of the situation, you can't please all of the people. All of them. You can't. You'll never do it. Those of you who are proceeding or are now in leadership, you can forget it. You can't. If it could have been done, I would have done it. That's true. If it could have been done, I would have done it, not in the process. Before I tried to. And I realize that there's only one deal, and that is first the Father, to please the Father, as the Son. That's it. That's the number one deal. And then if God ends up moving or dealing or fixing this, or you walk in one day and things change, you know what I mean? Then you go, oh, Lord, God, oh, God. Like something in, you know, you walk into a place and there's a bucket thing. You know what I mean? But you know, the steps of a good man are ordered of the Lord. And you, there is no, the minute you start saying it's got to be this way, God will just change it. Because it's not a certain way, and it's a Him. We've all fixed up, and we don't say, well, it's this one. And most of the time when we do that, we're not really looking at Him first. We're living down here. Our considerations are down here. Our relationship with the Lord and what we're hearing is down here. Our findings are down here. But I believe, and I thoroughly believe this, that there is a reality that all I know found in Christ, in Him we live, move, and have our being, that supersedes everything. Jesus seemed to walk in that. I mean, when He, you know, people, you know, remember in the fourth chapter, they came out and said, trying to change. We're trying to change the devil and make him act like God. We're trying to change our flesh and make it not weak, but our flesh is weak. See, how can you get mad at somebody when you know their flesh is weak? I'll tell you that. Here, please. Because, no, because you want them to change. You want their flesh to change from being weak to strong. But he's saying, no. My emphasis is change. Change from the government to the flesh to the spirit. When God get out of Romans 7, he's going by the flesh, but by the spirit. I'm saying, check it out. The word I, Romans 7, is used like, I can't remember. I'll probably be wrong. What I was going to say over 20 times. I think 22, but whatever. It's used a lot. You know what? The word spirit is used over and over and over and over and over and over and over. There was a change, but they didn't change the flesh into spirit. Wasn't that how it changed? It was a change from one to the other, not changing one into the other. Most of us go, we talk about susceptibilities. Susceptibility. I'm susceptible. Lord, I'm susceptible to this. Everybody in this room has susceptibilities. You know what? You don't ever get spiritual to so spiritual that you don't have susceptibilities. I want you to think about it. You do not, you never do. Why? Because the susceptibilities are in your flesh, and you are man filled with the Spirit of God. Where is the law of sin and death? In my members? Did he ever say that he would take that law away? No. He says he renders it inoperative by a higher spirit or a higher law. Renders it inoperative. That's just right for the Lord not to take it away. Because we're wanting to change it. And he doesn't change it. He just renders it inoperative as you would change from one to the other. Now, usually it's gone the other way, unless it's in such a way on this side, but not, but so it's not to confuse you. You still have to go through the cross, and there is an exchange. Or a change from one to the other, but not a changing of one. That would be an osmosis or evolution. We don't believe it. But your definition, many of you, your concept of the word change is an evolutionary concept. You are thinking that you are slowly getting better. You're not getting any better. Christ is being put on you. You'll never get any better. When I say that, of course, I'm talking about the flesh. Paul said, in me that is in my flesh is no good thing. On the ground of what I just said, and quoting that scripture, your flesh, or you, in that context, will never get any better. If you're not improving, you're not evolving. You're not osmosis. It is the example the scriptures give is transformation, and that transformation is the word metamorphosis in English. It comes from a Greek word, and it's where you get this concept of a caterpillar changing into a butterfly. But you know what? We just say, okay, well, we just kind of evolved. No, it wrapped itself into a cocoon of death. It was unseen, immovable, and not a caterpillar either. And then came forth in newness of
life. It wasn't just changed for the better, it was transformed. And that's a big difference. Well, okay, my emphasis much of the time for you is for you. My emphasis is for you to think in terms of you. Because I desire for you to realize what the process is so that you might move into it more and more and more. I mean, that's my desire. That as you know the Word and you know the Lord, you're changed from glory to glory into that same S-A-M-E image. Same image, not? In other words, it is Christ. The end result is Christ. It's not you. Paul said, not I. It's a me better. God be in my help. He said, not I. And that should be the goal, the desire, the all-consuming, so that every time you're involved in a situation, every time you're involved in mopping the floor, every time you're involved in being in charge of something, every time you're involved in a relationship with somebody, there's only one overriding thing. One and worse. And there's always a desire and always a looking to the Holy Spirit and a looking to the Lord and not letting those things slip. That's what Paul, I think it was Paul, said in one place. He says, don't let these things slip. Maybe it was the writer of Hebrews, but about it. Don't let them slip. We gather them up and then we let them slip. You know, and the truth by it, don't sell it. Don't give it up so easy. It's almost as if at times, it's almost as if we get in a place. God moves, and he's the great mover of circumstances. I mean, he's able to deal with circumstances. He brought that man, so he could be born there right at the right time, and he could impact the whole world, so that everybody had to go to their own path. You know what I mean? He just moved the whole world for one son. I got news for you. When he moves it all, he is moving for a son, not an immature child. But he can move those things. And he has the ability to move. But when he does, he'll have your demon going along. And he'll be dealing with you, trying to get you in a certain tenor, spiritual, emotional, and everything right here. So he's working. He brings this thing in, and he allows this. And there's this wall, and then there's this open door that takes place right here. All that because he's converging right there. And so with that, he's got to have other factors, spiritual factors, and maybe other people brought in at some time and all this. And he's converging it all together. Bam, man, right there. All of a sudden, at that point, it comes together, and we gather at that time precious jewels, precious treasures from the Lord. But then, the majesty of the circumstances and the majesty of the moment become what we think is all. And the spiritual, eternal truths that he's trying to embed in us, we don't really, really understand this moment. This tradition, reality, jewels that he's trying to find. We just have marvel at all the circumstantial and all of the how great that moment was, and we write it up in history and everything. And we walk out of this moment as far as the building. And he's building a building. Okay? But if we let it slip, then what happens is we basically end up all the way back down here, and he's got to go build a whole bunch of circumstances. And we're not as sensitive to the same kind of healing because, you know, I mean, he already said now, you know, he came in and said, you know, at one point he wanted to bring conviction so that you'd be open to him. He said, da-da-da-da. What an impact. And now if he said that similar thing, it wouldn't have quite the impact. And so he's got to come up with new circumstances to bring us to the same point, but it's not the same point that he's got to bring us to. It's the truth that is coming. That was there before you, and will be there long after, should we not accept it, or if we don't accept it. With many others. The only problem is, good thing is, if he can build this in and then add more and add to your faith this and add to your virtue and add to this and add to that, you know. You know, line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little, but line upon line, not line and, oh, that was really a good dream. You look back 10 years from now and you hear somebody share, you go, oh, I remember when I first heard that. You know, I haven't heard it since. Nor have I acted on it. Nor has it had any meaning in my life. I just remember hearing that truth, sharing it, and going, wow, that's a really cool thing. And I remember mostly how people were impressed when I shared it. But it hasn't really occurred to me since then. But so line upon line, precept upon precept, we're moving from faith to faith, from glory to glory. That's the scripture says, from strength to strength. The life of the Lord is like a new day. It's getting brighter, but that's his thing. That's the way he thinks. He just is. He is this God of progression. That's the way he thinks. He's really not the God of the wilderness, of wander endlessly, over and over the same ground. He's not the God of the wilderness. Now, he brought him into the wilderness, but he brought him into the wilderness as one step along the way. Fools will repent, because that's his way. And know this, regardless of what anything that I've said or whatever, if you feel any conviction or you felt you sense that maybe you failed in some way, regardless of that, God, your Father, I can assure you, he never gives up. Now, also, I need to tell you, though, that according to my searching of the scriptures and according to the things I've seen in relationship to him, sometimes when we go around and we miss that thing, it takes a while to bring you back around. I can give you several times when they're supposed to go into the land and didn't. Okay, well, we got 40-year deal. I saw it just vividly. I mean, it just, whoa. And I think that's one of the times it was branded in me. Always comes up on identity as well, is the covenant of the Lord. Because, man, they came into the land of Joshua. They started possessing, and they started taking the land, and they started, and they were of God, and the book of Joshua was just packed full of God, man. I mean, they were of God, they were moving with God, God did this, God showed them that, I'll fight for you, all this. And then comes the book of Judges. And in the book of Judges, they judge. And you tell me if it doesn't happen, they just go round and round and round. God raises up the deliverer. They rejoice. They go to the Lord. Then they sin. Then God has to send the enemy or allow the enemy and to come down upon them so that they'll cry out so that he can come deliver. But it's never, I'm delivering you. Oh, remember all this history. Now I'm delivering you. Don't you just love the book of Judges? It is, at the end of the book of Judges, he said, the problem is every man has done what is right in his own eyes. And there has to be a higher law. There has to be something higher than you that can demand or can circumvent your carnal mind. There has to be. And God sets up his word. God sets up spiritual authority, whether we like that or not. God sets it, you know what I mean? And these things are meant to help. I don't even know what I'm saying. Does that mean? other to live that life, and then the process can run back around. Another one who has running in their lifetime, and then at the end of their life, somebody else is raised up. We're talking year, year, after year, after year, after year. God is helping. But you know this, he was dying. And so then you come out of Judges. And Ruth, beautiful people, it shows us microcosm, heart of the times, out of Judges. Read Ruth out of Judges, I believe. I contrast it to this world. But it, and then you get one, and then you get it sad. Sad. And you get this woman who just, she just wants a son. More than anything else, she's barren. She's impotent, like this guy in John chapter 5. She can't bring forth. She's hopeless. What's the word where they were not respected because she couldn't bring forth in Israel. If you were a woman, you couldn't have children. You were looked down on, you know. But if you could bring forth, how great you were considered, because you might bring forth a son. And so here is this barren, this outcast. He sees her own wretchedness and goes, man, I just don't have it. Oh, God! And she throws herself to the Lord. Cries out. And so much so that, of course, the high priest, the top spiritual guy, looks at her and thinks she's drunk. And she's more close to God than anybody can see. He's over there going, "Woman, woman, you're drunk." God is at work now. Let me see. She responds. She was a man, of mankind. She opened the door to God into the earth. She submitted herself, not based on, you know, we say, "Well, man, Lord, would you come do this, man? You receive not because you ask not, nor because you seek to consume it upon your own lust." You're after what you want, you ask God to do it. He says, "No, I'm not going to feed your flesh. I'm not in the flesh feeding business, but I'll do those things for that reason." So he doesn't answer those prayers, but he does this. When she opens this, I just see this huge funnel up to God. Now, because it says, you read it, it says, there had been no word of the Lord in the earth, no prophet, it had been dead, silence. God had not been able to speak. And he just spoke to his prophets. Somebody not after. the tribe that we're of, where that comes from. Things go back to Benjamin and how Rachel groaned and travailed as she brought forth his son, Joseph being the only at that time, Jesus being the only Joseph, set on the front line over the whole world. And she only had two. All those others, 12 tribes, were concubines. Leah. There were only two. They're the original one. They're on their way back to the land, having lived in the land for all those years. And she groans, travails as she sends over. And as she gives, brings forth life, she gives up her life. Now, other points when Joseph vacated his dead was his brother Joseph. And Joseph's king of Egypt, he says, are there any other sons? And they said, yeah, there's one more. And he said, well, I'll tell you what, I'm going to put so-and-so in prison until oh, no, he didn't have that time to do it. He says, bring him back. I want to see him. It's his brother. It's his real brother. It's his, Joseph and Benjamin. I want to say, really? Through that line. And he goes, bring him back. And they didn't. The family got so bad that they had to come back. And they came back. And he said, where you guys been? And where's that? Our father will never let it come. Okay. And I'm gonna jail. It's mine to be good. So Benjamin came. We saw Benjamin and they're gone. And father loves this son. It's the only son. It's his only son. Don't kill him. This whole story is really built on a father-son relationship. I got off a little on that just because the truth is tied so much together. I mean, even that situation was a situation where there was all this seed born and they went round and round and round, and then Joseph ends up in prison. Of course, he ends up in Potiphar, and then he gets in trouble with Potiphar, he ends up in prison, then they forget about him. They forget about him. They forgot he was down there. The word of the Lord is testing him to see it. When he's down there and it's dark, what does he believe? You hear Joseph calling, we got some problems. The East Coast, two time life. Second of all, the grass down there. Third of all, you can't be forgiven. Let me tell you, that's visions. Dreams I've had. I better see some people jump here to bring forth what God's got in mind. No, no. Joseph didn't say that. Jacob said that. Joseph brothers, right? They're one and the same. They're one and the same. Jacob was this schemer who kept trying to fulfill the will of God by making it happen. And finally, he got his name changed when he got the box of God and came out of heaven. Anymore to do anything. I've got to go, Prince of God. There you go. There's my main man. Prince with God, right there. What? Why are you saying that, Lord? I was more useful to you when I had all this physical. Because every time you did something, I promise I was going to bring forth that thing. And I brought it forth. Brought that forth. And I gave that to you by promise. You got proud, you got, and I'm working again, or you would start scheming again when the next phase would come. And you go, yeah, man, I did this, and I brought this back. She's over here with this and that, and I, you know, it's planning, working, you know. And of course, when you sow that, you get slipped up on. He loves Rachel. So somebody schemes and slips a leader in there, and that's the way 7 more years that you did what you sow. All this happened outside of the land. It happened in the land right on the edge. It was a good weapon. He got his name changed once he got the land. They're not anything written. It's not just pregnant with reality in life. The Bible is just the most glorious book. It is just full of the glory of God. But it's supposed to be as full of the glory of God. It's full of the glory of God. Later on, they walk up, and this man, one of mine, says, which one's sin? His parents or him? This is why you're glory. Glory of God. Oh, you mean so God gave glory to Jesus? Got to be some big event that brings God glory. I think God is pleased that people see what He wants to do until Jesus showed up. Brothers, some men, Jesus touched them, and immediately their eyes were open. The first thing they saw was Jesus. Now I see Jesus. He spits on the ground and makes blood. Wipes the blood. And the guy that said, go wash, go walk in the pool of water. He goes and washes. And then something is changed. And the whole rest of the story. Not until that miracle of the man in the sea. The whole rest of the story is that there is this progression in his walk before he sees Jesus. Because he saw Jesus as, he must be a God. And then later on, he must be a prophet. And then later on, this and that. Finally, he says, my Lord.
He thought that, these were the
Father, we just thank you for this time. We ask you to bless it. Continue to bless our understanding. We know that at this moment we may not understand.